off. Happy Saturday. Good evening. We welcome you. If you are tuning in on Zoom, which you should be, or YouTube, wherever this is. There we go. Wherever this is streaming, we thank you for joining. We thank you if you're watching it on the replay. If you're present tonight, if you're in the building, wherever you fall on the spectrum, we welcome you. We thank you for joining. We love you here at the White Nation. You are welcome. Go ahead. And, you know, if it's on YouTube, you can share it. You can send it to someone, send it to a family member, a friend, a neighbor, someone that you know needs to hear this word. We're starting with a brand new series in this month. We're talking about maturity. We're talking about growth. We're talking about development. We're talking about just beginning to go through the processes of the Lord that he would take us to and through in order to mature us, in order to develop us, in order to grow and stretch us. So we're going to be talking about all of those things this month. It's a brand new series. Apostle is ready to dive deep into it every Saturday and Sunday, and we're excited about it. So we thank you for joining. We thank God for what the word is going to do for you throughout the remainder of this month, in Jesus' name. So as you already know, we do our fire starters, our corporate prayer intercession. You can go ahead and stand to your feet if you're in the building. Even if you're at home, if you want to hop off the couch, jump out the bed, whatever you want to do, go ahead, stand to your feet, lift your hands, lift your heavenly language. If you're not filled, that's okay. You can still lift up your native tongue, your English language, and you can say, God, I love you. God, you're amazing. God, you're faithful. God, you're worthy. God, you're big. God, you're merciful. God, you're gracious. God, you're strong. God, you're righteous. God, you're excellent. Whatever you want to say to him, but you can use your native tongue, your English language. But if you're filled, go ahead and lift up your heavenly language. Come on, South. Yes, right there. I hear you out there, South. I hear you. Come on, come on. Lift it up. Lift it up. You're here. You might as well do it. Come on. Come on. Don't play with it on tonight. We're starting a brand new series. So come with some fervency. Come with some aggression. Come with some might and some strength behind it tonight. Father, we give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. We thank you just for you being great, just for you being mighty, just for you being strong, just for you being excellent, just for you being righteous, just for you being worthy. We begin to give you glory. We begin to worship and praise your name, because we found that your name is matchless. We found that your name is majestic. We found that your name is miraculous. We found that your name is safety. We found that your name is strength. Your word says that the righteous run into your name and they become safe. So we thank you because your name makes us safe. Your name provides that safety. Your name is that pavilion. Your name is that thing that blocks and that barrier that keeps us protected even from the wiles and the snares of the enemy. So we lift up your name. We lift up your name as that standard, because you said when the enemy comes in like a flood, to lift up the standard against him. So we lift up your name to be that standard on tonight. We lift up your name that every time we call your name, you begin to come and heal. You begin to come and cleanse. You begin to come and deliver. You begin to come and strengthen. You begin to come and make ways out of no way. So we lift up your great name in this place. And we thank you even now, oh God. that you are a God that specializes in doing the impossible. We thank you that there is nothing too hard for you, that there is nothing that you cannot do, but you are the greatest power. And because you are the greatest power, you are unbeatable. There's no other power that can do what you can do. We begin to proclaim and we begin to release, even in the earth, that there is no other power quite like you, that you can do what no other power can do, that you specialize in the impossible. As we look at your track record, as we look at your resume, we see that you consistently do the impossible. You consistently move in a way that we can't fathom. You consistently heal in a way that we couldn't even dream. You consistently provide in a way that we couldn't even think. So we thank you just for being who you are, just for being a God that specializes in the impossible. Yes, oh God. So Father, even tonight we thank you as I begin to loose the members of the Way Nation South into the processes of maturity, growth, and development. I thank you, Father, as I begin to even decree right now that the members will begin to engage in deeper intimacy with you in order to progress in their maturity. So I thank you, Father, that throughout this month, as we begin to be educated and as we begin to be equipped and activated in regards to maturity, in regards to growth, in regards to development, that you will begin to stretch out and you will begin to stretch the members of the Way South, that you will begin to show them how they are to mature, show them how they are to grow, show them how they are to be developed, begin to take them through the processes of maturity, begin to walk them through the stages of development in Jesus' name. I thank you that they would submit to the processing in which you want to do, that will cause them to be matured, that will cause them to be developed, that will cause them to be fully grown. I thank you that you would take them through the several stages of sonship and through the several stages of maturity for those sons that once were nepos and once were babies and toddlers and infants in the spirit, that they would begin to grow and they would begin to go to the next level. So from Nepos to Huios and Huios to Technon and Technion to Pater and Pater to Telios and all of the other stages, oh God, that you would begin to walk them through, that you would begin to process them through each and every stage, and that they won't be able to go to another stage until they master the previous one, in Jesus' name. So I thank you that they are prepared for the work, and they are committed and disciplined and diligent to do what is needed for them to be able to progress in maturity and be able to progress in growth and in development, in Jesus' name. I thank you even now, oh God, and I command that the souls of every member of this house, Way South, that their souls will be pliable unto you, oh God, that they will begin to conform and comply to your processes, oh God, that they will begin to comply to the process of maturity in which you've designated and ordained for them, oh God. So I thank you that they won't shirk back from the process, that they won't run away from your process, that they won't try to get away from it, or they won't try to avoid it, but I thank you that they would submit and they would surrender to the process of maturity. I thank you that they would surrender and they would submit to the process of growth. I thank you that they would surrender and they would submit to the process of development, even now, in Jesus' name. I thank you that as you show them who they are to be, as they learn and as they are educated and as they are equipped with the tools and the knowledge for them to be able to realize the different stages that they may be in, and that you will mature them and take them to the next level, that you will pull them up to the next stage, that they will come away from being just like an infant or a toddler or a child, but they will begin to come and become full grown, that you will perfect them as a matured one, as a son that is mature, in Jesus' name. I release Telios over them, even in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you even now. And I begin to decree that you would begin to apply necessary pressure to the souls of each member of the Way South, oh God. Apply pressure on them, oh God. Apply pressure to them, oh God, so that they can begin to be fostered into the depths of maturity as you take them deeper, as you take them to the 30, the 60, the 100-fold of maturity, as they begin to master each and every stage of maturity, that you would begin to apply the pressure. That you will begin to put pressure on the places in which they are kicking against the pricks and the places in which they haven't submitted, that you would put pressure on the places that they haven't surrendered in, that you would apply pressure even in the places where they haven't still given over their will for yours. I thank you even throughout this month that as you apply the pressure that they will begin to submit, they will begin to surrender, they will begin to come under what it is that you want to do in their life and how it is that you want to grow them, how it is that you want to develop them, how it is that you want to stretch them, how it is that you want them want to mature them, even in Jesus' name. So I thank you now, oh God, that as you're stretching them, as you're applying pressure, that they won't run from the pressure, that they won't try to avoid it, oh God, but they would submit to it. So I thank you even now that you would apply pressure to every son, apply pressure to every member of the Way South, even as they join on the Zoom call, even as they join every Saturday, let them come prepared for what it is that you would speak through your word. Make their hearts pliable, make their ears ready to receive, make their hearts softened to be able to receive the word that will go forth, and make them implementers and applicators of what it is that you will say. Let them apply the word. Let them apply the principles. Let them implement the concepts so that they can see the growth, so that they can see the maturity, so that they can be able to track their development. In Jesus' name, I thank you now, oh God. Stick with it, South. I know you're out there. Continue to lift up your heavenly language or even your prayers in English. I feel your prayers out there. But God, we even thank you. And I begin to decree and declare that even as the members of Way South, as they will progress through the different stages of growth and development, that you would progress and push them through the different stages. So I thank you that as they go from Nepos in the stage of being an infant to Helios, the stage of being a toddler, and then even to Padion, and even to Technon, that the stage of adolescence, and then even to Pater, oh God, to the stage where they would become an adult, and they would become a father, and they would come in a perfected maturity, and even in the stage of Telios, oh God, that you would begin to cause a strength and a development and a mastery of maturity to come over them, that our excellence in maturity as Telios will begin to be released and begin to come over them, even in the name of Jesus. So I thank you, oh God, that as they're given the principles to master maturity, that they will comply and they will conform and they would actually work the process to do it how you say, oh God, so that they can actually mature. So I thank you even now, Spirit of Truth, that as you begin to show them the level that they're at, because some of them may think that they're at a level that they're not at. Some of them may think they're further along than they actually are. Some of them may think they're at a higher stage than what they really are. But I thank you that you would speak to them, that you would show them, that you would reveal unto them the stage in which they're actually at. So whether that's Nepos, whether that's Helios, whether that's Telios, whether that's Pater, whether that's Technon, whether that's Padion, that you would show them where they are and show them the steps and the ways to master where they are so that they may get to the next stage and that they may begin to progress and develop to get to the next stage and the next place, even in Jesus' name. So Father, I thank you, and I even begin to come against and I bind and rebuke any things that would hinder the depth of their maturation, oh God. So I come against lack of trust for some of the members and the sons that would have a lack of trust in you throughout the process, for the ones who don't want to trust you, or for the ones that have difficulty trusting you to mature them, trusting you in the process, trusting you through the stages, trusting you through the steps. I thank you that even now that lack of trust would be combated, and we begin to cancel it and reverse it even now, that they would begin to start to trust you, and we would release even the antithesis in place of it, oh God. So even in the place of lack of trust and distrust and mistrust, we release trust and faith in you, faith for you to take them through the process, faith for you to grow them, faith for you to mature them, faith for you to develop them in Jesus' name, that they won't go with the lack of trust, and that lack of trust continues to keep them stuck and stagnant. But I thank you, even as I said previously, as you apply the pressure and as they submit and surrender to it, I thank you that you will begin to stretch them and show them where you need them to be. So I thank you that even as they trust you throughout the process, as they begin to comply with your processing, that you can really then mature and grow and develop them, even in the realm of the spirit, in Jesus' name. So even every unrepentant heart, oh God, for there's some that has a heart that hasn't repented, for there's some that has a heart that would still hold on to things, that some of them have a heart that is not after your own heart, oh God, and that's the thing that will keep them stuck, that's the thing that's keeping them stagnant, that's the thing that's keeping them as an infant. But I thank you even now that in place of an unrepentant heart, we release the antithesis, and we release repentance, that they will begin to repent, and they will begin to turn away from those places of stagnation. They will turn away from those places of being frozen and still, and they will work your process. They will do the things that you would reveal unto them. They will begin to implement and apply the principles that they will learn through apostles' words each and every Saturday and Sunday. And as they apply those principles, even in their personal and intimate time with you, I thank you that you would then begin to show them, and you would begin to grow them, and develop them, and mature them, and their heart will become pliable, their heart will become bendable, their heart will become movable, their heart will become able for you to begin to twist it and turn it in the way that you would want to, that their desires would match yours, oh God, and that's when they would mature, that's when they would be developed, that's when they would be fully grown, that's when they would be stretched in Jesus' name. So I thank you even now that even in the places where they want to hold on, even in the places where they're scared to go to the next stage, scared of what that may look like, scared of what the next level may entail for them, scared of what the next level may contain and consist of for them, I begin to rebuke and bind the fear even now, oh God. I thank you that as you would begin to develop them, as you mature them, as you progress and you grow them, oh God, that they would no longer fear what's next. They would no longer fear the next level. But even just as we as humans have to begin to progress, and we can't stay babies forever, I thank you that you would grow them, that you would show them, that you would take them through the processes, and that they would not fear it, oh God, that you would come and take them by their hand and walk them through the process, walk them through the stages, walk them through the steps, oh God, show them how to apply it for their own life, to where it looks and makes sense to them, in Jesus' name, to a place where they can apply it even in their own life, and they can see it even in their own life, that it may not look like everybody else's process, but I thank you that each and every individual and solitary process, that they would commit, that they would conform, and they would comply to it, in the name of Jesus. So even we speak to idolatry even now. I begin to rebuke the idolatry that some of them may have had something else set up in place of you. Some of them may have had some idols and some foreign deities and some foreign altars that they placed up in front of you, and that they placed in front of your process, and they placed in front of your altar, that they placed in front of your throne. So we even dethrone every foreign deity. We even begin to snatch down every idol, and we push them down, and we cast them to come down to their face, place, and we begin to kick them down, oh God, so that you may erect yourself, so that you may be the God that would stand strong in their soul, that you may be the God that would be sovereign over their soul, that you may be the God that would be the Lord of their soul and the Lord of their life. So I thank you even now that every other altar, every other deity, every other idol that they had in place of you is cast down, it's snatched down, it's torn down, it's pulled down, even now in Jesus' name, that there won't be a thing that would hinder them and keep them from progressing, that the idols won't be the thing that will stop them from getting to the next stage of maturity, that those idols won't be the thing that would keep them stuck and stagnant where they are, stuck and stagnant at knee posts. No, we pull them out of those places. We pull them up to the next level. We pull them up to the next stage. We pull them up through the rungs of maturity. We pull them through the levels of growth. We pull them through the stages of development. Even in the name of Jesus, we command that they will begin to move. We command that they will begin to work the process. We command that they will be diligent. We command that they will be committed. We command that they will be disciplined, even in the name of Jesus. So we even come against the laziness. We come against the disobedience. For some of them, they know what they have to do to go to the next level. For some of them, they know what they must do to get to the next stage. But yet they want to continue to be disobedient, and they want to continue to stay stuck in the ways of old. But I thank you even now that new wineskins will be given. New wineskins will be released, and you will begin to stretch the capacity even now of your members and your sons of the way south, that they will be prepared and equipped and activated and quickened to begin to go through the levels of maturity and the stages of growth and the stages of development. So every place in them that wants to stay stuck, every place in them that wants to stay frozen in time, every place in them that wants to stay stagnant in a moment, I snatch them out of those places. I push them out of those moments. I push them out of those places. I push them out of those stages. Even now, in Jesus' name, we declare that we will mature together as a house, as one, each and every individual in that solitary process, but together as one church, as one commission in multiple territories, that we will mature as one, that we will grow as one, that we will develop as one. In the name of Jesus, I thank you now that we will be ready, we will be equipped, we will be activated, we will be committed to the processes that you will want to take us through. Even the leaders, that as you stretch them, as you grow them, as you develop them, as you cause them to mature and to matriculate, that they will begin to go to the next level, they will begin to go to the next stage. We begin to call forth for pride, for arrogance, for narcissism, for cockiness to bow on its face. We knock it down. We begin to say that we are pliable. We're pliable in your hands. We're pliable in your hands. We submit to you, oh God. We say, grow us up, develop us, stretch us, mature us, equip us, activate us, quicken us, even in the name of Jesus. Oh, yeah, the best, yeah. Oh, namaste, kaya rebe ya bashe. Oh, ya na 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 be so ya na na basha ya. Yeah, na 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 ma ma so cool. So even the unwillingness for some of the members to make a decision, for them that want to stay in places of uncertainty, I snatch them out of places of uncertainty. I speak to every mind that's confused, every mind that's struggling with doubt of, are they ready for the next stage, that if they can handle what's next to come, if they can handle what the next stage would entail and would look like, I begin to snatch them into places where they can begin to be committed and diligent and disciplined to your process in Jesus' name. So even their unwillingness to make a decision, I release certainty over them. I release conformity over them. I release compliance over them. Even in the name of Jesus, that we will begin to comply, that we will make the decision to be begin to be stretched, to begin to be progressed, to begin to be matured, to begin to be grown, to begin to be developed. We make the conscious decision, and we say that we're ready. We know that it won't be an easy process, oh God, but we say that we're ready. We say that we're ready. We stand and we say that we're here, and we're ready for whatever that you have to do in us, through us, with us, to get us to the next level. Hey, even in Jesus' name. And oh God, I even speak to the lack of commitment, because there's some that have a lack of committing to a process. You've given them the process. You've laid it out before them. You've shown them the steps, but they've started it, and then they became inconsistent, and they fell off the wagon. They started it, and then their commitment waned, and they began to go astray. But I thank you even now that you will pull every son back onto course, back on track, back in alignment, that you would recalibrate them even now, that they would begin to commit and put their hands back to the plow, that they would begin to be ready, to be stretched, and to be activated, even in the process, even now. So I thank you even now, that if they won't commit before, I release commitment over them. I release commitment over them. I release obedience over them. I release obedience over them. I release commitment over them. I release obedience over them. We will obey. We will commit. We will be disciplined. We will be diligent. We will be consistent. We say you can process us, oh God. We say you can grow us, oh God. We say you can mature us, oh God. We say you can develop us, oh God. We say you can activate us, oh God. We say you can stretch us, oh God. We submit. We surrender. We comply. We conform. We submit. We surrender. We comply. And we conform. Even in the name of Jesus. Hey, oh God, we thank you now. I thank you even now, oh God, that every son is being obedient even now, that every son is ready to walk this thing out even now, that every member is ready to be equipped, to be stretched, to be activated, to be developed, to be matured, to be grown. In Jesus' name, I thank you even now. So God, I thank you even now. And we come against even the dysfunctions, oh God, that would keep us stagnant. We come against even the dysfunctions that would try to keep us still, that would try to keep us bound, and would try to keep us locked in at one place. But no, we say we are ready to grow. We are ready to mature. We are ready to progress. We are ready to be stretched, even in the name of Jesus. So I thank you even now that the dysfunctions that once were holding us back can no longer hold us, can no longer keep us, can no longer stagnate us, even in Jesus' name. So I thank you even now. I command even now that every son, every member that will watch this, that you would activate and quicken their hearts through the word that will be released, and that something will spring up and leap up on the inside of them, that fire will begin to be released and baptize their souls, even now in Jesus' name, that they will go to the next place, and they will not conform. In the name of Jesus, we say it is so. We say amen. We say it is done, and it shall not be otherwise. In Jesus' name. Yes. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name.
Come on, Way Nation. Come on and lift up the name of the Lord in this place. Oh, we welcome you, Abandi Oroboseke. We welcome you, Abandi Oroboseke. We welcome you, Father, Abandi Oroboseke. We welcome you in this place, Andy Abababase. Roba Babandi Oroboseke, Yoroboso. Yamamamamamaseke, Yamamamamande Oroboseke. We welcome you, Abababase. We reverence you right now in the name of Jesus. We magnify your name, God. We lift you high. We glorify your name in this place. Oh, magnificent God, you are. Wait, nation, welcome. Welcome to South Saturdays on this evening. You're joining something that's already in progress. You're joining a move that's already in progress. You're joining us for something that's already going. So just get hip to it on this evening. God, we welcome you. We welcome you. Come on and lift up the name of the Lord in this place. Hallelujah. Come on and lift him up. Begin to lift him up with me on today and just worship his name. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Oh. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Father. Jesus, we worship you. Oh, oh, oh. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fight till I'm found. This is risen. Come on and lift up the risen Lord on this morning, on this evening. Come on and lift him up on today.
Oh,
Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, come on, and let the glory of the Lord begin to descend in this place like fire. What you want us to be, God. Oh, if the altar's where you need us, take me there, take me there. If what you need is just an offering, I'm right here, my life is here, and I'll be a living sacrifice for you. You're refined, the refiner. I wanna be consumed.
I wanna be tried by fire.
Purify. You take whatever you desire.
Lord, Lord, here's my life. I wanna be tried by.
Purify,
purify, you take whatever you desire, Lord, here's my life.
Let it fall, we want it all, if your fire is consuming, fill this place, set it ablaze. And I'll be a living sacrifice for you. You're refined, the refiner. I wanna be consumed. Come on, lift up your hands and sing. I wanna be tried by,
purify.
You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. Be tried, purify me, Lord. You take whatever, Lord, is my life.
I
love this part. It says, clean my hands, purify my heart. I wanna burn for you. For you, oh, take my life as a sacrifice. I wanna burn for you, only, only for you. Oh, clean my hands, purify. Refine the Lord. I want to be sensitive. Can you tell him you're a fire?
You're a fire.
The refiner.
The refiner.
I want to be.
I want to be consumed.
You say, I want to be tried by fire. Purify. You take whatever you need. I give you all of it, Lord. Lord, he is my. I want to be. Take whatever you desire. Lord, is my life. Clean my hands. Purify my heart. I wanna burn for you. Only for you.
Just for those who are ready, say,
take my life. As a sacrifice, I want to burn for you, only for you. Oh, clean my hands, purify my heart.
I
want to
burn for you,
only for you.
Take my life,
Lord. As a sacrifice, I want to
burn.
Have the clean hands and clean heart.
Oh,
clean my hands, Lord. Purify my heart. I want to
burn.
Only for you.
Sacrifice.
I want to burn, Lord.
Only for you.
The refiner. I want to be consumed. You're refined. The refiner. I want to be consumed.
You're refined. The refiner.
I wanna be
consumed.
I wanna
be refined. The refiner.
I wanna be
consumed.
I wanna be tried by fire. Purify. You take whatever you desire.
Lord, here's my life.
Lord, here's
my life.
You take whatever. Lord, here's my life.
Lord, here's my life.
You take whatever,
Lord.
Lord, here's my life.
Lord, here's my life.
Burn me beautiful. Burn me lovely. Burn me righteous. Burn me holy. Burn me beautiful. Burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous,
burn me holy,
burn me beautiful, burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful. Burn me lovely, burn me righteous, burn me holy. Purify, purify. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life.
I wanna be tried by fire.
Purify. You take whatever you desire. Lord, is my life. Oh. Come on and worship him right here. Right here in a moment. Let him hear your song. Oh. Oh,
is my life. He is my life. Oh, He is my life,
right there. Like, just take a minute and listen to the lyrics. Burn me beautiful. Burn me lovely. Burn me righteous. Burn me holy. If that don't get you into worship, man, I don't know what will. Well, good evening, Way South. Woo! Hopefully you able to come out of that heavy worship that we was just in, but good evening. Good evening. I am so happy to see all of your beautiful faces on the Zoom. Hopefully you are enjoying the worship. Give it up for the worship. That was good. That was good. Ooh, that was still hitting me. That's still hitting me. It's still hitting me. Well, I just want to hope you guys are having a blessed evening right now with those beautiful lyrics. Pastor Murphy, Executive Pastor Murphy. Here today to give you guys today's announcements. Woo! As you guys know, we got a lot coming up this month. Okay, we got a lot coming up. Starting off with Shiel Woman. Woo! Give it up for Shiel Woman beginning March 16th. That's coming up pretty soon. Every third Wednesday on Zoom from 7 to 8:30. Contact Pastor Beasley for registration. You see it on the Zoom. You see it on your screens coming up. You guys want to get into the Shiel Woman class. That's some good womanage right there. That's great. It'll bless you. I promise you. I was with my mama last time she was doing it. It was amazing. It was amazing. I learned so much about becoming a woman. You want to do it. Next, we have Catching the Culture Assimilation Series. Woo! We've been doing the assimilation on Tuesdays, and it's been great. I've been learning about the culture of the house. I learned a lot. You want to learn about the culture of the house, and you want to get into it with the house, get in tune with the house, get on the assimilations on Tuesdays. Then, of course, we have our Fast for Apostle on Thursdays, lifting up our leader. We have our weekly objectives, 8-hour fast, okay? Make sure y'all know it's 8 hours. It's 8 hours. Then we have our Resurrection Weekend. Woo! Sunday, we got a big breakfast. Come on now, who don't want some good breakfast at 10 a.m.? Okay, and then afterwards, we're going to have an Easter egg hunt. If I was a kid, I'd do it. If I was able to do it, I'd do it. I love Easter egg hunts. Bring your babies. Easter egg hunt. And then we got bowling fellowship. Last time we had bowling, we had a blast. I had a blast. It was so good. It was good fellowship. Lots of laughs, lots of loves. And then, of course, we have Resurrection Sunday. Woo! In person. We guys want you to come in the building. We guys want you to celebrate Resurrection Sunday with us. Starting promptly at 11 a.m. Promptly.
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 Promptly
and
at 11 a.m.
Coming up, we have First Fruit Sunday.
First Fruit Sundays. Woo, woo, woo. First Fruit Sundays. Everybody give it up for Minister Taylor. Amen. Amen. Give it up for Minister Taylor. Give it up for Minister Taylor. Amen. This is our first time doing announcements. You are going to see her tomorrow as well doing announcements. And for maybe a few weeks. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm scheduling her right now. Amen. Hallelujah. So, but yes, give it up for Minister Taylor. She was awesome. This Sunday, upcoming March is all First Fruit Month, but of course, First Fruit Sunday is March 27, 2022. That is the day that you sow that first fruit seed that God has given you, that He has told you to sow. So we want everyone on that Sunday, March 27, to bring your best gift as we honor God with our first fruit offering. Amen. I want everybody to bring a first fruit. Everybody. Amen. Hallelujah. And guess what, Way Nation? It's offering time. Woo, woo. Amen. As you prepare yourselves for the tithe offerings, the wonderful gifts, the expressions of love, we thank you for your faithfulness, your cheerfulness, and your faithfulness to give here at the Way Nation. On your screens, you will see in just a few seconds the many ways to give. Way Nation, you give abundantly already. Y'all heard the total that Apostle said at the WNVC, and we are climbing already. Amen. What the Way Nation, it does what it's supposed to do. Amen. And God is increasing every single one of us, so I'm excited for that. He may be moving people and putting monies in different places. So if you have not already given, like I give on Friday when I get paid, I know a lot of the other ministers and pastors and elders give as soon as they get paid on Friday. That's our first thing. We wake up, the tithe. Amen. Hallelujah. So we want everyone to go ahead and avail themselves to our different ways of giving and give on today. Give and give as a cheerful giver. Amen. Apostle talked about giving a couple weeks ago, and it revolutionized my way of thinking about giving. So I'm going to make sure that I give happily from now on. Amen. I'm giving my seed happily, and I'm giving it to God. I'm not giving it to anyone else. I'm giving it to God on this day. So, amen. So we're going to go ahead and pray over the offering. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, we honor you, we bless you. We give you glory just for the seed that is sown, oh God. God, we thank you that it's going to come to us 30, 60, 100-fold, 1,000 times greater back to us, God, because we have sown it into this great ground. God, we come against anything that would try to come up against our seed right now. We come against the cankerworm and the palmer worm that would try to eat up our seed in this next season, oh God. And we put this seed into the ground cheerfully, oh God. We put it in the ground happily, oh God. We are happy to give it on this day in the name of Jesus. So bless this seed as you have continued to bless us, oh God. So we give you glory, honor, and praise in your Son, Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. I want everybody to give it up for Apostle Corey D. Butler. Amen.
Come on, Zion, let's give it to him, to the man himself, Jesus Christ. Come on. He saved you. He loves you dearly. And we're going to give him glory while we can. We're in the midst of a brand new series now and getting ready to go into that today. I just want to preface going into things with this, that each day, Saturday and Sunday, are going to be different messages respectfully. So what does that mean? That means that today I'm going to preach one message. Tomorrow I'm going to preach another message. And it's going to all be a part of the whole divine scheme of things, okay? So I want to get you guys accustomed with that. Elder Murphy, do me a favor with these lights. I like blue. Yeah. I like blue. Let's just make me blue all over the place. Amen. This red stuff behind me makes me nervous a little bit. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. So we're going to prepare ourselves to dive into the inner recesses of another series. This series is called It's Time to Grow Up. It's time to grow up. Look at your neighbor and say, it's time to grow up. I remember years ago when Toys R Us was still a thing. And they had a mascot. His name was Jeffrey. And he was a great big old giraffe. And Jeffrey said, I don't want to grow up, because if I did, I wouldn't be a Toys R Us kid. And so they were fighting not to grow up. And as much as we would want to do that, I think we just got to come to the place where we got to say, it's time to grow up. Amen. All right, Murph, let's go to work. There's something I want to show you first. I want to ask you a couple questions before we dive into this. Okay? It's coming up on the screens right now. First slide. What is go to the next one. Next one. Can somebody tell me what that is? Who? Okay. Go to the next one. What's that? See, somebody said pistachios. Somebody said seeds. Okay. All right. Click the next one. What's that? Lemon tree. And then what is the next one? What's that? Lemonade. Can you do me a favor? Can you tell me what is the same and what is different about each one of these things? Who? Each thing is a lemon? Just different stage of lemon. You're absolutely correct. And so I want to share with you this because I want you to gravitate towards, some of you are in seed form. Some of you are the tree. Some of you are the fruit on the tree. And others of you are the lemonade. But each of them are still forms of the lemon, but just at varying stages in their maturity. Say that with me, say varying stages of their maturity. From the seed stage all the way up to the cup stage, as it were. Each has a designated maturity mandate. The seed has a mandate to do something particular. The tree has a designated thing that it will do. The lemonade has a designated thing that it's supposed to do. Each one of them, while they are the same thing at a different stage of development, all have a particular mandate. Say a mandate. What I want you to understand about this is I want to talk about the word mandate for a minute. Say mandate. The word mandate is a specific commission. Say specific commission. It's a specific commission and a formal command issued by a deity, sovereign, or governmental authority to the official personnel or citizens under the purview of a representative government, empowering them, to perform the specifics of the commission and the command. So I want to let you know something, that God has given us a mandate of maturity. Say a mandate of maturity. So it's a commission inside of a commission. Come on, walk with me with this. It's a commission inside of the commission. And it's also a formal command. How many of y'all know God does, when God issues a command, it's not like we have an option. Let me say that again. When God issues a command, it's not like we have an option. When my mama say, don't do this, and I'm a child, what's supposed to happen? I'm not supposed to do this. All right? So we need to understand that this mandate is very serious. It is not something that we can just sit around and play with. You understand what I'm saying? We got to be so serious and so, and we have to prioritize God's mandate. Let me preach here, right here, in this place. We got to prioritize God's mandates. There are times that God will put a mandate on your life and to do a particular thing, and you will put it on the back burner until it becomes suitable for you. As soon as you're ready to get blessed by it, then that's when you do it. And God said you defaulted on the mandate because the mandate was supposed to be done at the moment that I gave it. It was supposed to be done at the moment that I commanded it. And if it wasn't serious enough for you to do then, it's not serious enough for me to bless you now. And so you got to understand that not only is it a command, but it's a commission. We've talked ad infinitum about a commission. Commissions come with empowerments, with authority, with position, with posture, with mindsets, and so on and so forth. So whenever God gives a commission inside of a commission, the commission inside of the commission is for the greater commission. Come on. So when God gives us the commission of what? Maturing, there must be something he's getting ready to do. Come on, y'all missed that. If God has given us the commission to mature, there's something that he's about. Okay, y'all missed it again. If God has given us the commission to mature, there's something that he's about to do. Okay, let me go back to the first service of the brand new year. It's about to be big. So you got to mature for you to become what? Big. You got to mature so you can handle what? Big. You got to be able to be in position so you can handle when it comes. What? Big. You can't handle big if you've not matured beyond small. Are y'all with me? You gotta mature. This has to be a priority. Write that down. God's mandates must be my priority. I didn't write that in the notes. That came from heaven. God's mandates must be my priority. Because let me tell you something. When you make God's business your priority, and that's when God makes your life his. Oh, they didn't want that. I got quiet on that one. When you make God's priority yours, he will make your life his. I have found that when God's priority becomes mine, I get bumped up in the line for the blessing. Can y'all handle that? So the idea is that we must prioritize them. Whatever they are, we must prioritize them. Now, hear me when I say this. God doesn't want you to become imbalanced. Okay? Let me say that again. God doesn't want you to become imbalanced. He wants you, okay, he wants you to take on the mandate. But as you take on the mandate, this is the thing that he wants you to do in the midst of it. He wants you to put the mandate in priority, but he doesn't want the mandate to have exclusivity in your life. Thank you, Elder Murphy. He said he just want to be first. That's it. Y'all ready for something? I'm going to give you something. I'm going to show you how to balance your life out real quick within 10 seconds. You ready? It's a 10-second balancing act. I'm telling you. It's going to work. Okay? Here it is. Understand that your work for God is not your ministry to God. Because you'll prioritize the work and not the ministry to him. But if you give him his ministry, he'll show you where the work face is. God will always give you more time in your day, especially if you put him first. I found when I get up at my 6 o'clock hour and I have my time of prayer and I take my time until 8 o'clock, 2 hours. And then by 8 o'clock, by the time 8 o'clock hit, I'm ready to go about my day. I've entered my day. I'm not distracted. I'm very focused on what it is that I need to do. Why? Because I've given him what he requires. And so now I have a right to ask him to order my steps and to order my day because I put him first. It's the principle of the first fruit. When you put God first, he's going to make sure everything else lines up and give unto you in an abundance. Say, put him first. Many times we don't put God first. You have to mature to a place where you put God first. You do. You have to mature to the place where you put God first. Many people, and here we go. All right, since I'm here, I might as well go ahead and do what I do. Here's what I want you all to grab hold of. That in states of immaturity, we will do for God, but we will not come to God. I gotta evangelize. I gotta pray for this person. And your time with him is so short.
that your own personal dedication and your own personal validation in God is hinged upon what you do for him, not what you do in the presence with him. He just dropped this on me. Mandates make you hear him. Mandates make you hear him. I'm going to say that again. Mandates make you hear. See, whenever God begins to deal with a mandate, there's something not only that he's trying to do, but it's something that he's trying to say. What do I always say? God is always. We're not always. So what does that mean? That means that a man that sits outside of eternity always got something to say. But this is what happens. This is exactly what happens. When I take my ear out of eternity, it appears that God stopped speaking. It's not that he stopped speaking. I just moved out of the direction of his voice. Okay, here we go. Let me give it to you like this. If I'm in the room and I'm talking to Lan, and I'm talking and I'm talking and I'm just talking, I'm just talking. Side little thing. I'm just talking, right? And I continue to talk, but I presume that he's there. Then he leaves the room and goes downstairs, but I'm still talking. I'm still giving instruction. He's just out of place. The question that you have to ask yourself, if you've not been hearing God lately, are you out of place? Because he sure is, and he's still on the throne. Where are you? Where are you? And it requires maturity for you to ask that question. Where are you? It takes an even more mature person to answer it. Okay? Let's go deeper here. Y'all ready? So God has given us a mandate. And as I was preparing this lesson, the Spirit of God told me, he said, I want to give you heaven's manifesto on maturity. Heaven's manifesto on maturity. And so some of y'all look at me like, what in the world is a manifesto? Guess what? I got you faded, player. A manifesto. Y'all ready? It's coming on the screens in a second. A manifesto is a published declaration. Say a published declaration of intentions, motives, or views of an issuer, be it individual group, political party, or government. So this is God's views on maturity. This is what he's saying about it. All right? And I got to deal with something very quickly because this is what's coming up in my spirit to deal with zeal. Zeal is not maturity. Zeal is energy that you get when you first save. Maturity says, all right, I'm saved now. I got this wonderful zeal, and my zeal takes me into a situation, and I'm ready to jump into it. Maturity says, shh, let it play out, and then see. So let it, let it play out, and then see, okay. So here we go, watch this, true story. Y'all ready for this? True story. All right, when I got saved, I had a lot of zeal, and I can't lie to you, I had a lot of zeal. I loved to study. I would stay up for hours studying. I was 9 o'clock hit, homework was done, it was word time. All right, I got my Bible open, I'm cracking my Bible open, I'm reading scriptures, God is talking to me in my right ear, because that's how you used to, we always talk to me in my right ear. Okay, and my ear used to get very hot at that time. So that was God's way of training me to hear him. Now it don't get hot, he just talks. Okay, so he starts talking to me and talking and talking, and I got my strong, see, that was before I had Esau. Praise God, thank you, Father, for Esau. I bless your name. Bless the creator thereof in the name of a hundredfold. Okay, so before I had Esau, I had all the books that Esau has in it. Okay, so I got all these books open. I'm studying words. I'm reading books and everything like that. And I was so zealous about the information that I had. But I had no maturity and development to temper my zealousness. So then I had a whole, my family had a lot of Jehovah's Witnesses at the time. My auntie was a Jehovah's Witness before she died. And so she came over and she had her Jehovah's Witness friends with her. And then I had my uncle had just got saved, and he had become a Christian, going to Crusaders ministry with Apostle Eckhart. And so him and his friends came by, and they were, I was ready. You didn't want to tell you, I was ready. I had just got done studying the whole faith. I went from front to back on that cult. You hear me? And so I was ready. This is the first time I've ever heard the voice of the Lord audibly. All right? And they were going back and forth, and I was trying to say, and the Spirit of God said, shh. I looked around, said, hi. I said, what you say to me? I'm sure ain't nobody say nothing to you. So I was puzzled. And I said to myself, self, now I know you didn't say shh. Grandmama say she didn't say shh. You was watching the mouths of everybody else, and they didn't say shh. Who say shh? So I'm thinking, I said, who say shh? Maybe I'm just hearing things. So I find myself back into a place, Rock, where I'm getting ready to jump into another part of the conversation. All right, you feel me? I'm finna wreck shop on my auntie. I love her dearly, but I was finna destroy her in the word. I was finna wreck her with the Greek, the Hebrew. I was finna launch her through Christology, the whole nine yards. All of it. I was ready. You hear me? And then I got ready to say something, and I heard, shut up. I said, okay, now I know that wasn't me. Did nobody else move up in here? And I say, sir? He said, that was me. Shut up. Guess what I did? I shut my mouth. I shut my mouth for the whole night. I ain't say nothing else for the whole night. I shut my big mouth up. I shut up. I shut up. I got scared because I knew when God speaks audibly to you, it shakes your reality. It's a different when he's speaking in your ear and your spirit. No, when this man spoke outside of my bashokoya, he spoke outside of my body and it shook me in a way that I'd never been shaken before. And I knew his voice at that moment. That was a maturity moment. Because it took maturity to shut my mouth and not get involved in something that my zeal was about to get my butt whooped on. So I was quiet. I let them do the talking. I said, okay, let me be quiet. But that's how I learned. And we got to be careful with zeal. And this is one of the things that if you stick through this series, your zeal is going to become a motivator. And it's going to give you momentum. But you're going to have maturity to begin to temper that with to know how to apply wisdom. I hope that made sense to you. Because this is critical now. So now let's go to work. This is a very elongated word about what God wants to say in regards to heaven's manifesto on maturity. Murph, make sure it goes up on the screens so that they can see it, so they can follow along with it and whatnot. All right, let me make this big because y'all know what's up. Let's go to work. He says, It is in this next era. What do we do? So I'm dry. Oh, they can still hear me. Praise. All right. What we do? They can still hear me. Y'all can still see me. There we is. And we don't care what it was, but it ain't gonna stop us. So we got it right there on the screens. It's finna come back up for those. Okay, praise God. Here we are. For it is in this next era that I am mandating. Maturity. All right? It has been on my agenda for some time now. Many of you have undertaken it, but still many of you have not. Your personal agenda has been a priority to you and not my will and my agenda. He says, this surely is causing a retardation of my plans and purposes because I don't have sufficiently mature personnel to man stations that I need to be manned during this time. He says, there are things for this house and even my body that are a decade behind because maturity has not been on the agenda. He says, yes, many have been educated and informed, even trained, but how many have been developed, intentionally grown, intentionally developed, intentionally matured? There must be an intentionality behind development. For this house I say that your professional development days must be days of true development. They must be planned purposefully and prudently executed. For there's a professional prowess that I'm looking to create amongst the members of my body. There are several areas that I'm commanding growth and development in for this house and even for my body. He says soul growth and development. There's 16 of them. Soul growth and development, psychological growth and development, spiritual growth and development, professional growth and development, emotional growth and development, intellectual growth and development, educational growth and development, relational growth and development, destiny growth and development, identity growth and development, financial growth and development, mental growth and development, your health, your physiological health growth and development, your office growth and development, your familial growth and development, and personal growth and development. There's 16 areas that the Spirit of God is mandating that we got to get you grown up in. Say 16. 16 is the number of double resurrection. 16 is the number of a new beginning. Y'all missed your shout right there. 16 is a number. 16 is that number of revival. And so what he's trying to say, yeah, preach on me now. And what he is trying to say is that I'm going to redeem the time by causing 16 things on the inside of you to begin to mature. And once I begin to cause those 16 things to mature, you're going to redeem the times. You're going to begin to walk up circumspectly before me. And you're going to begin to cause the things that you thought that the enemy thought he had pushed back. They're going to begin to speed up to find you. All right. Each of these areas of growth and development will provide you with what you need to walk on the course of destiny and in your identity, and then the tools of your giftedness and talents will make sense. And those secondary talents and gifts will be realized, and you'll begin to develop the primary gifts and talents. Let me explain that. Many times what we will do is we have a secondary comfortable gift that we like. That secondary comfortable gift that we like is the one we want to build up. And the reason why it is because it does not require much to build. But that primary gift is the one that requires sacrifice. It requires change. It requires going through the fire. It requires going through the crucible. It requires, I feel God now. It requires all of that. And so what we will begin to do is we will take a second seat. And not the primary, the secondary gift in the primary seat, because it does not require much of my character. Does not require much development. It's that primary gift that you called in. My secondary gift is to prophesy. I'm a prophet by second nature. My first nature is apostleship. So I had to go and study it. I had to go and immerse myself in what it was so that I could develop that in me, so that I wouldn't rely on the prophet in me when I was called to be an apostle. Y'all missed it. Some of you are relying on the second gift, and you ain't taking time to birth the first gift. And this is because you have not matured to the place. Come on, Zion. You have not matured to the place where that first gift can take a first seat. Primary gifts are those that you don't want to be developed because of the pressure and the pain that are required to move in them at a specialist level. God is calling for specialists. The specialist level requires a level of dire change. Say dire change. The Spirit of the Lord says that He, through time, He, through this time of development, will begin to break dysfunctions. It is the negative growth and development that creates dysfunctions and causes retardation in the lives of my people and an obstruction to my plan. I'm coming like a mighty wind to change the trajectory of your life. For like Jonah, and many of you are deliberately on your way to a place that I have not called you. This is because you've not taken your development seriously. He says you will enter into processes, but you've not entered into mine. And the Spirit of God says that when my time is up for my process, there will be no entry. God gonna let some people stay retarded till the day they die. Watch what he says. He says, you have mocked me by speaking the language of the mature and disguising yourself as mature, but you are not. There's an effort to hide immaturity, but I'm bringing to light the areas of immaturity so that they can be swiftly dealt with and my people can continue the upward journey that I have for them. I'm going to place my people in the crucible of growth and development. You will sleep there. You will eat there. You will become there. For the Spirit of truth is mandating that development be at the top of your list. It will require decision, discipline, and diligence, and will cause great levels of deliverance. Sharpen my word and see that the innocence or the immaturity of Adam and Eve. Look at the maturity of Noah and what it produced. Take Joseph and his process of maturity and ascension into position he had. I'm beckoning my sons to a place and position of power, but I will only place power in the hands of the mature. I will only place power in the hands of the mature. For the novice will be stricken by pride, but the telios will with meekness be exalted. For I'm commissioning you to revisit every program and every ministry and ensure that it is maturing that its mentoring and maturing components are in place. Your focus over the years has been deliverance. However, deliverance without a delivered state to enter into will only result in people refracting back to old ways. I gotta stop here because we gotta deal with this. You come up, you slob on this flow. That's why we ain't got no carpet down here, because you slobbed on it, waste water on it, and everything else like that. And here we go. All right. And see, you get up off this flow, and guess what happens? You get up and you free from bondage, and you go back out, and you go back around the same stuff with the same people, the same climate, same ecology, the same ecosystems, and that stuff begins to sow on the inside of you again. And next week, you back here doing the same things. And guess what? It is because there's no maturing. See, God says that, he says, no longer will you prostitute my deliverance anointing in this house. He said, because you prostitute, you go out there, you get yourself in bondage, you want to come and snot on the floor and expect me to deliver your mess, but your mess has not been in submission. And so you got to understand that this man is serious. You want prophecy that you don't qualify for because you're immature. You want a man that you don't qualify for because you're immature. You want a future that you don't qualify for because you're immature. And then you got the nerve to try to steward something in your immaturity, and your prayers can't get them anywhere. And this is why you defaulted on your prophecy. I don't care how much we shout about the blow up. I don't care how much we sing about the blow up. I don't care how much we prophesy the blow up. The blow up will never happen with the immature people that cannot handle the power behind the blow up. Shout up in here, tear the stage up, tear the floor up, shouting these new chairs, and it never blows up, and we're trying to figure out why, because we didn't grow up. We can't have a blow up. I want you to understand. He don't care how old you are. He wants maturity at the level to which you can mature. He ain't trying to say, you 12, mature as a 12-year-old. Don't try to mature as a 21-year-old. He says, what you're going to do is you're going to miss what I have for you and default at what I have for you at the level that I have it for you. Okay, all right, okay, okay, okay. So here we is. Here we is. I'll get back to this word here, but here we is. Some of you want to be teleos, and you ain't master nepos. You're still immature. You still get offended too quickly. You still carry unforgiveness, and you say you've matured. Lies from the pit of hell. You think maturity is all about somebody educating your mind? Maturity happens when your heart starts to get matured. Maturity happens when your character gets matured. Maturity happens when you start growing and developing in how you talk to folks. Growing and developing in how you understand folks. Growing and developing with your comprehension. Growing and developing with your offense issues. Growing and developing with your forgiveness issues. Growing and developing with your whole identity piece. You gotta grow and you gotta develop. How many of y'all know that there's a level of power that is necessary to bring to pass some of the prophecies that you've been given? Come on, Zion. There's a level of power that's necessary to bring to pass the prophecies that you've been given. You can't pray at an immature level of power and prayer and assume that God is going to bring together a prophecy because you have not ascended to the place where the power can be released and be the wind in the sail of that prophetic utterance. I got power. You see that here? I got power. Everybody got power. You got power. I got authority and power. And authority and power. I got authority and power. But you can't keep your hands out your pants long enough talking about you got power. Your heart is still wrong and you got power. You'll still cuss me out with the quickness and you got power. No, 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 no. That ain't power. That's called retardation. That's called a spirit that'll keep you in a place and in a cycle, and it will make you think you grow because you're acquiring information. But information without application is simply a big dumb fool. Let's go to work. Take Joseph and his process of maturity and ascension into the position that he had. I'm beckoning sons and daughters into a place of power. But I will only place power in the hands of the mature. He says, so if I am commissioning you to revisit. Okay, I said all that. And watch this. Watch this. He said, your focus has been on deliverance. However, deliverance without a deliverance state to enter into will only result in people refracting into old ways. For today, I will begin to download the new program called Pathway to Maturity. The basis of it will be this series of lessons, and it will provide basic tools for growth, development, and maturity. I commission this house to revisit this subject yearly, create assessments and tools to help the people become sons. Y'all bought my book, and I praise God for it. I appreciate every purchase. I ain't gonna even lie. I signed it for you. But buying the book ain't gonna make you become. See, there's a place between reading and application called conviction. Yeah. See, some of y'all wanna read and try to apply, but ain't been convicted, because conviction is the impetus of change. Come on, say that when you say conviction is the impetus of change. So where we going first? We got to deal with this thing called the spirit of retardation. The spirit of retardation. I was about to say somebody, he abruptly snatched my lips because I was going to say something that's probably going to be offensive. So I can't say it. But if you ask me in private, I probably will, because I'm not standing up here and everything like that, okay? Just text me and ask me what I was going to say. Hopefully I remember. You don't snatch it from my mind. Here's what I want y'all to get here. Many of the people of God have been retarded. Now let's look at what this word retarded means, because we use stuff out of its denotative context. Okay, the dictionary meaning of it is it's a verb. It means to delay and hold back in terms of progress, development, and accomplishment. Look at the three things: progress, development, and accomplishment. Do y'all hear that? So you have a status quo to begin to look at yourself and say, how am I retarded? Have I accomplished what he said I'm supposed to accomplish? No, retarded. Have I developed the way I'm supposed to develop? No, retarded. All that, development, accomplishment, progress. I've made minimal progress. And notice that retardation doesn't mean you have stopped progress. It said slowed and minimal progress. If you've been in this church any length of time, if you've been in this church any length of time, the thing that I want you to grab a hold of is that maturity is going to happen. But you'll get into a pattern of dysfunction, the cycle of dysfunction. We got to talk about that in a little bit. But I want you to understand that maturity is going to happen. You going to mature. You going to learn. Something going to get you and hit you in your heart, and it's going to change you. But based upon how resistant you are to the word, it's going to determine how long you stay retarded. A show that I like, I don't watch it as often as I used to. It's called Family Guy. And there was an episode where Peter Griffin started to get certain benefits because he said that he was retarded. And that's how he said it. Hey, Lois, I'm retarded. It was just like that. That's exactly how it was said. And so I had to look at that. I was looking at that episode, and I'm thinking, this is what we're saying to hell. Hey, devil, guess what? I'm retarded. And the devil knows you're not talking about in your mind. He's talking about in your destiny. He's talking about in your identity. Retarded identity, retarded destiny, retarded character, retarded behavior, retarded opinions, retarded attitudes, retarded perspective, retarded perception, retarded. Slowed down. Coming to give you something, Minister Taylor. Coming to give you something. No. I'm coming to you. Coming to you. I can't get to you in enough time. The time for me to give you what I was supposed to give you has elapsed. Not because you retarded, but because I'm retarded. How many of you have people connected to your commission that are retarded? You can't get pushed like you need to get pushed because they were retarded. They can't understand the significance of time. They retarded. I can't get you to pray right because you're retarded. I can't get you to fast for me because you're retarded. I can't get you to stand with me because you're retarded. I'm all the way up here and you all the way back there, and I can't get you to do nothing because you are retarded. Somebody's going to see a clip of this and presume that I'm talking about someone's mental status or those that may have mental disorders. This is not the context of that, and I would not tolerate such foolishness because you want to have a viral soundbite and blurb. So anybody that desires to do that, the judgment of the Lord be upon you. Want to know how you can recognize retarded people? Look at me. You ready for this? Y'all ready? They lack priority of God's will and agenda. Watch this. The spirit of retardation preys on the immature and the developmentally weak. Watch this. The spirit of retardation focuses on the pain of the process and not the processing of the process. This is too hard. I don't know how I'm going to do it. And you spend more time bellyaching about the process that you want God to just promote you through so that he could just get, you don't have to go through nothing. Don't have to go through nothing. You just want God to skip you all over the board like you the king in a chess game. Not really realizing that if you take the king out of place too quickly, he'll get checked and checkmated even quicker. So you want God to skip you over some processes? Checkmate, hell. All right, you want God to skip you through that pain? Checkmate, uh-huh. Yeah, you don't have the enemy in check. The enemy has you in check because you don't have what it requires to survive the pressure and the pain of a process. So you got to understand that God still got the devil in check. He's still, the devil is still under his employ. Y'all forgot he created good and evil. So this man will use evil as long as it's to his benefit and then cause that which was evil. Thank you, Joshua. Thank you, Joseph. That which was evil, God turned it around for my good that many might be saved. Y'all ready? Y'all hear what I say? The reason why he turning bad stuff around for you was because, number one, Joseph was in position. The thing that they meant to kill him by putting him and selling him into slavery, the thing that was meant to kill him, even though he was mature, God said, I'm going to let it mature you. The thing that was meant to kill me has matured me. The thing that was meant to destroy me has made me even more powerful. The thing that was meant to take me out has made me an assassin in the realm of the spirit. That thing which hell desired to do has made me a terror to anything with four legs and called a devil. But watch this, that scripture can only work when you're in position. Joseph was in position. He wasn't in the pit. See, good, watch this. Before he got to the pit, everything was all good. Walk with me. Then he gets to the pit, that's when everything turned all bad. Now you can start to see how it's working for his good. Sometimes God has to let you go into the slavery of hell to allow you to begin to mature out of that slave mentality. Something on the inside begins to then click. You realize that, wait a minute, my daddy's name is Jacob. He wrestled with God and God called his name Israel. I am one of the sons of Jacob. I am not a slave. I am a son. And I'm going to show you how good it worked for him. It worked so good for him in that process till when he got to Potiphar's house. can I share something with you? I'm just navigating the text, and this is just coming out of me right now. The aroma of maturity will attract Potiphar's wife. Don't miss that. The aroma of maturity will attract a Potiphar's wife because her whole design is to snatch your mantle. But what she didn't realize was that she was just preparing him for the next mantle. You could have that one. I outgrew it. You can have that. I outgrew that. Yeah. You want 809 Edgebrook? Fine. I outgrew it. You want 1487? Fine, I'm outgrowing it. You missed your shout. You missed your shout. You just moved in there in September. How are you outgrowing it? Because God already showed me my forever home. Y'all missing me. They missing me. They not understanding me. Sometime God shows you the next level while you're in the current level, so you know what you got to work to get to the next place. You're frustrated where you are. No, baby. Frustration means you took your eyes off of what he was trying to show you. You're looking at how slowly you're moving. See, it's the difference when you're moving in God's time vis-a-vis when you're moving retarded time. Oh, hear me when I tell you this. Watch this. Watch this. The spirit of retardation diminishes progress by creating and maintaining systems of dysfunction. Watch this. Your dysfunction don't look like my dysfunction, but the system of dysfunction works just the same. And so when you're going through a dysfunction and I'm going through a dysfunction, I'm not able to help you out with your dysfunction. But once we learn how the dysfunction works, then we can apply the principle and say all we got to do is come out of this. And whatever stage this is for you, I see God's cloud in this place. And whatever this is for you, and you stop this, and when you stop this, that's when everything else, the domino effect happens, and bam, you're out of the cycle of dysfunction. Because this, you watch this, watch this, watch this, watch this. Oh, Jesus, you are just one deliverance and decision and the diligence session away from breaking the cycle. I'm one. You mean to tell me I had to be diligent and get my heart right before he elevated me? Okay, all right, okay, all right. I had to be diligent and got my heart right before he gave me a new position. I had to be diligent and made a decision to keep my heart in perspective so I could break the cycle of dysfunction, staying in seasons and times that God have never called me to stay in longer than I've been staying in them. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Can I preach? I need to preach. Watch this. The spirit of retardation attacks comprehension. It attacks clarity. It attacks creativity. Listen to what I'm telling you. When you are under attack from a devil called retardation, its design is such that it slows you down and defers your hope. The Bible says that hope deferred makes the heart grow weak. When your heart starts to grow weak, then your heart starts to give in to the wicked ways of its weaknesses. Who can know it but the one that created it? And so as a man thinketh in his heart, so then he becomes. You become weak. You become retarded. You become slowed down. You become dysfunctional. Why? God, own thing God got to do. Own thing God got to do if you want to promote. Own thing God got to do if you want to promote is God got to change your heart. And the only way God can change your heart is if you give him a decision. See, God is tired of you going back and forth playing double dutch with a decision on him. He says, if you're going to give me a decision, then you got to be diligent to it. And the minute you make a diligent decision, then that's when I'm going to bring deliverance. He said, in this season, I'm not bringing deliverance another further until you make a diligent decision. Until you make a diligent decision to do what I've asked you to do, I can't give you deliverance because I'm tired of being prostituted. I'm tired of being used. I'm tired of being abused. You talk about substance abuse. You talk about spousal abuse. You talk about child abuse, I want to talk about God abuse. How many times do we bind this man, demanding that he does something for a refractory people? God, you got to get me out. You got to get me out. I need your grace is sufficient for me. I need grace, Jesus. And only because he's faithful to his word. How many of y'all know that some of us is out because he's faithful to his word? That's the only reason why some of us is still here, because he's faithful to his word. If he wasn't faithful to his word, where would you be? If he was not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent, whatever he said he would do, whatever he said he would bring it to pass, where would you be if he was not a God of integrity? Where would you be if he had the capacity to lie? Where would you be if he did not fulfill the promises of his word? Attacks comprehension. Our comprehension is under attack. why you can't understand what's happening in your season. This is why it seems like God is speaking in dark speech, because retardation has attached itself to your comprehension. It's attached itself to your clarity. It's clouded your clarity. Because it knows that it can't take it away. It just clouds it. And as long as I'm cloudy, how many of you have had to drive in the fog? You have to drive in the fog. And then you turn on the fog light. And then the light starts to reflect back off the cloud. So now you have to slow down until you get out of the cloud. The cloud ain't there always. It's only there for a season. The cloud understands time. The cloud of confusion understands time. If I can get you confused for 4 months, because that spirit knows how to read the timing of the Lord, it's something that we don't know how to comprehend. We know this God that we say we know real good, and we can't even comprehend how this man tell time. Well, then be there on March 13th at the Now gathering, because then I'm going to tell you about the nowness of God. I'm going to tell you how the now time of eternity and the now time of Kronos kiss and make a Kairos moment. And I'm going to tell you how Kronos is a science, that when you start operating in the science of Kronos, you will step into a place where every time is a right time. You feel me in this place? You'll start to step into a place where prophecy has no choice but to find you, because you stepped into the now. Even though it may be then, it's still now. Even though it may be later, it's still now. Even though it may be bad, it's still now. Why? Because I've stepped into the anointing and the posturing of the Kairos. Y'all tired of me yet? Just tell me you're tired of me and I sit down. Just tell me you're tired of me and I sit down. The Bible says, this ought to make you shout. Lambo, come get my watch. This ought to make you shout. Lambo, come get my watch. Lambo, come get my watch. Come on. Come get my watch. This ought to make you shout. Here. See, one day you'll have this, but you got to be paying attention to the voice to know when you can get it. He'll figure it out. He'll turn 14. He'll be like, wait a minute. Godfather told me I was going to have this, but I got to pay attention to the voice. See, watch this. Watch this. You got to know when to sew up. You got to know when to sew up. I know how much that costs me, but I also know how much I know what I want. You got to know when to sew up. You're missing what I'm saying. You're missing what I'm saying. Sometimes you got to give up so you can get up. You missing what I'm saying. Some of y'all don't even understand where I'm going with this. You don't even understand where I'm going with this. Some of y'all don't even understand where I'm going with this. Some of y'all don't even understand. See. Some of y'all, oh, Lord, help me. You got to realize that when you're in a season of maturity and maturing, you got to know when to give up. You think I'm talking about sowing and reaping. I'm talking about giving unto him. I got to give this up. I got to give that up. I got to give this up. I got to give that up. I got to give this up. Because when I give unto him, he gives it back. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Then watch what he does. He's so much God that he'll make men give to you the same thing too. I'm sorry, I'm a little bit excited. Excuse me. John chapter 8, chapter 3, verse 8 says this. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but can't tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone born of the Spirit. Say the winds of change. Say the winds of change. Come on with me, Zion. Say the winds of change. See, some of you don't understand why all hell broke loose now, because the winds of change are about to blow. You don't understand why you had to make some decisions, because the winds of change are about to blow. You don't understand why hell has cut up in you, because the winds of change are about to blow. And if your sail is turned the wrong way, it'll blow you backward instead of to the place where God has for you. Say the winds of change. Say the winds of change. Say the winds of change. Do me a favor, stand up and sit back down and high five somebody and say the winds of change. The winds of change. The winds of change. The winds of change. The winds, the winds. The winds, the winds. The winds, the winds, the winds. The winds, the winds, the winds. The winds. The winds, the winds, the winds, the winds. See, we're in a place right now where when you start to mature, God will fool around and blow the winds and change your whole life around in a day. You've been thinking it's going to take God a long time. The winds are blowing. The winds are blowing. You'll start to get some stuff that you ain't even asked for, because the winds are blowing. The way I feel like preaching now, the winds are blowing. But some of your sails are wrong. Your sails, your sails, your sails are wrong. I need somebody who in need of a 24-hour change to stand up on their feet right now and start turning and adjusting to your wind. I need somebody right now who say, God, I know that you're getting ready to do something ridiculous with me, and you require me, so I need to start turning and adjusting right now. Yep. The winds of change are blowing. Watch this. Some of you just started turning, but you didn't feel the wind. I remember years ago, I was teaching sons and daughters the move of the Spirit of God. And I said, I want everybody to close their eyes. And I want them to pray in tongues for a few seconds. And then when you begin to feel the wind of the Lord, I want you to lift up the hand of the way in which the wind is coming. And when you begin to lift up the hand of the way in which the wind is coming, that's how you know in which way to turn. See, you turn into the wind, because when you turn the sail into the wind, it blows the sail this way and the boat goes that way. That's what change is all about. I got to change something for me to go to the place where I need to go. The winds are blowing. Come on, somebody prophesy. Say the winds are blowing. Point at somebody and say, I don't mean no harm by this, but the winds are blowing. 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 And watch what the text says. Look at the last word, four words of the text. So is everyone that is what? Born of the Spirit. Those are sons. Those are sons. See, I understand why God got me dealing with maturity, because all from September on, I'm going to be teaching about what? Sonship. Everything that I didn't teach last year, I'm going to teach it this year. And everything I got to teach this year, I'm going to teach it this year. Because sons have to what? All right, okay, come on, Zion. Sons got to arise. It's about time for sons to get up. And when they start to arise, they're so far high above the pay grade of hell that the attacks that the enemy wants to render against you, then you can qualify to say, no weapon formed against me shall be able. Okay, all right, sit down. We're just talking. Sit down. We just talking. We just chilling. We just conversing. Sit down. We just conversating. Sit down. Way Nation. Sit down, South. Right now. All right. If you ain't gonna sit down, shout now. Shout for the change. Shout for what he's about to do. Shout for how he's about to move. The winds of change are blowing. Reason why the winds of change are blowing is because this man is about to break the cycles of dysfunction. There's a weightiness on me tonight. I'm smiting the mantle down tonight. This is how dysfunction works. You ready? This is how dysfunction works. You get information, you get comprehension, and now there's a fork in the road. It either becomes integration or disintegration. Not to disintegrate, but disintegrate. Integration means I make it a part of me. And see, watch this. Integration only comes when there is conviction. Change don't come where it ain't been convicted. See, you can't confess what you ain't never been convicted of. Watch this. And so now, but let's say you in this posture of dysfunction, right? Y'all ready for this? You ready for this? Here we go. Check it. This thing's so good to me right now, I don't know what to do. Y'all ready for this? Okay, I got to come down. Y'all ready? This is what happened. Once this integration happens, we move into this thing called recalibration. You got to recalibrate after you got to that word, that thing that you're getting ready to reject, and I'm not integrated it into you. Then watch what happens. Once that word comes and it is rejected, you go into something that I call habitual fallback. You go back to the place of, as Minister Charles Hancock would say, comfortability. You go back to the place of comfort. But then let's go deeper. Then you go back to dysfunctional reset. And you go right back to the place that's called information, comprehension, disintegration, habitual reset. And so you become so accustomed to that till you'll get a word, you'll receive it with gladness, but it never gets sown inside of you. And the root is on top of the ground, and the sun in your life will beat it up and dry it up, or the ravens in your life will come and eat up the seed, and you never become. You never become. Still with me? I got something. I'm almost finished. I ain't lying. I'm almost finished. I just say this with me. Say the process of becoming. Say it again. Say the process of becoming. See, many of us become ever so frustrated with God's processes, and we become frustrated with God's processes because there's no easy way out. I play a game, my iPad, called Domination. Any time in the day, you'll see me playing it. Sometime in a meeting, I'll be playing it. Some of y'all don't want revelation, you don't want counsel, you just want an ear. And while I'm listening, I'm playing and let you talk. So here, listen here. I'm playing this game, and I've been playing it for about a good 2 years, and I done built my civilization up to the atomic age, to the atomic age and whatnot, the Cold War age, and I got to get to the atomic. No, I'm at the atomic age. I got to get to the Cold War age, and so I'm so busy about fighting and stuff and enjoying the fight till my progress was retarded. And so they have little things that you have to go through and things that you would do to earn stuff, and I'll use all this stuff up. And then I found myself buying cheats to progress. Some of us, we want to bribe God with our service and think as he's going to give us a cheat code to get out. And the little things that I do, $2, $4, $3. It got so bad one day, Deanna. I fooled around and paid $29 for one. And I said, wait a minute, what has become of me? I'm that thirsty to get out of this process that I don't want to develop the way I need to. I don't want to upgrade my soldiers so they can fight better and be better. I just want to get others. I just want to get higher ranking weapons so that I could beat up people but never mature. All I want is good, is higher technology. I don't want to mature to the place where I can actually build it for myself. Listen to me. Listen to me. Y'all ready for this? Say this with me. Say, I am by nature of association a builder. I am by nature of association a builder. I am by nature of association a builder. I'm apostolic by nature. I'm apostolic by commission. I'm apostolic by mandate. I'm apostolic by pedigree. I'm supposed to create new technologies. The reason why creation is waiting on you is because you have a technology in you that liberates it. Do you think I'm spending my time educating you so that all of the wonderful creations and technologies can come out of me and have my book, my name on the book? No, 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 no. Mm-mm. See, there are four types of people you have in any organization. You'll have doers. You'll have thinkers. You'll have mind. What I say they is? Visionaries. And then you'll have what? Masterminds. The doers are just going to do what you tell them to do. They ain't going to do nothing more or nothing less. If I say go and jump one step, they jump one step. They don't think about the next step. They don't care about the next step because they are cool in the game with fulfilling the duty of what? Doing. But then you have those who matriculate, feel it now, who matriculate through the process, and then they become thinkers. Not only can they do, but now they can think and troubleshoot. They can be over there and say, okay, now wait a minute, ain't nobody gonna tell me why this thing just went off. So now I got to go over here and figure this stuff out for my, okay, now wait a minute, hold it, this and went off. Okay, well, let me unplug this. But oh, I thought about it. I thought about it. See, that's maturing. Then you move to a place where you stop becoming a thinker only and you become a who? A visionary. Because visionaries can not only just do, they not only can just think, but visionaries have the capacity to see. It is when you have visionaries around you that you can talk vision, and vision can be actualized on the inside of the thought processes of a visionary. A visionary, all they have to do is hear the word, and they will begin to see the word, and they'll begin to give you strategy for the word. See, that's why you got to have bosses around you, because when you sit down with the bosses, and all you got to say, you know what, this is what God telling me, I want telling me to do, and then the bosses start getting it, and the visionary on the inside, and you start writing on a whiteboard called a soul, and then out of their belly starts to flow. Come on, out of their belly starts to flow wisdom, out of their belly starts to flow strategy. But you got to mature to that place. And so now, then you get to a coveted place called who? A mastermind. Yeah, mastermind. I feel like preaching, but I can't preach like I want to because a mastermind is the individual that has seen the end at the beginning. Y'all miss what I said. They have the character of their God because it is their God that has separated the end and completed the beginning at the end and the end at the beginning. And so they now begin to move in the full power of the image of God. And what begins to happen is that when a mastermind steps on the scene, they will look at a building and say, I see all the potential in the world here. This can go here. That can go there. Take that wall down because I see the reality of what could potentially be there, and they can begin to architecturally design something that can't nobody else see. And so this is why masterminds need doers to just follow it, thinkers to orchestrate it, visionaries to see it and to execute it, to create masterminds. I need about five people that's going to take this prophecy seriously that I'm about to give you and run with it for real. Here it is. God's trying to make you a mastermind this year. I need five people that are ready to take this prophecy and run with it. God's trying to make you a mastermind this year. But I got to go back to this scripture right here. The winds of change are blowing. He's going to have to blow your mind. Y'all missed it. He's going to have to blow your mind to the place where the way that you used to think, you can't think no more. Because a mastermind can't think like that. A mastermind can't think like that. That's why some of y'all are amazed at my mind. Because my mind is the mind of a master. Because my mind was made by the master man. Only comes through maturity. This wasn't no creative preaching, and this came through maturing in his presence. How many of y'all want to go to Ignite because you want to glean in educationally and gain a lot of information and sound smart? What'd I say? Was that shade? That was shade. Say the shade, the shade. It's all right, because guess what? In a book called Children of Destiny, Dr. Patricia Morgan wrote this in a book. She said, Corey, you will be a shade to many. They will come underneath you, and they will rest and find rest. So yes, I'm giving shade. This is what shade looks like right here, because I'm giving shade. I'm the one that has to be a mastermind. They got to keep growing. They got to keep my roots down deep underneath the ground, so that when the wind starts blowing and change starts blowing, you may change the direction that you blow me, but I'll never be blown down. Process of becoming. 1 Corinthians 13 and 11. Process of becoming says this. When I was a child, I used to speak like a child. I used to think like a child. And I used to reason like a child. This is the turnaround in the text for me. It didn't say, but when I became a man. NASB, it says, when I became a man. It says this. NASB now. It says, when I was a child, I spake as a child, I thought as a child, I reasoned as a child, : when I became a man. Come on. See, the thing about it is that God doesn't want to cancel your childhood. He just wants you to transition into adulthood. I know, Grandma, I just don't use it a lot. Watch this. The colon oftentimes is designed to indicate a list of things that you become. So watch what happens. When I became a man, I did put away childish things. This is what God is challenging you to change. How I speak, how you think, and how you reason. Let's just go into the text for a minute. Can we go in the text? Can we? Please let me go in the text. Let's go in this text here, because once we go in this text, I want to show you something. I want to show you something here in 1 Corinthians 13. Yeah. 11. I want to show you something. Ready? When I spake, and leo. That word leo. Okay? That word leo, to talk, to speak forth, to tell, to whisper, to utter, to proclaim. Watch this. This is good. You ready? It means, what am I proclaiming? Not just with my mouth, but with my life. Your life speaks. What is your life speaking? Does your life say? Watch this. Another meaning is to declare, to use words in order to declare the mind, one's mind, and to disclose one's thoughts. Watch this. your life discloses the mind of the deity that you represent. Selah. Selah. Or your life will disclose the pantheon of deities that you represent. Y'all kicking it with me? Y'all kicking it with me? Watch this, Minister P. Watch this. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood. Uh-oh, here we go. Okay, here. Foronio. Y'all ready for this? Here it is. Watch this. It says, to think, to have an opinion of oneself, to think of oneself. Wait a minute, hold on. Not just how I think, but how I think about me. How I think about everything else. See, watch this. Your thought process suggests your worldview. So how you thinking is how you looking, and how you looking is how you opinionating. How you thinking is how you looking, and how you looking is how you opinionating. Y'all ready? Here we go. Yeah. It really breaks down to this other word called phren, P-H-R-E-N, phren. And it means the faculty of the mind to perceive and judge. So now when I was a child, I understood, I perceived and I judged like a child. I perceived and judged like a child. And then here's the last one. Y'all ready? Here's the last one. I got to get you out of here. I thought as a child. Y'all ready for this? I thought, here we are, logismai. Say that word, say logismai. Say it again. Logismai means thought. It means considering. It means to take inventory. Logismai is not just a thought, it is a thought process. It is a mentality. It is a way that you think. So now I got to move from a childish way of thinking about everything. Everything ain't about you. Everything ain't got nothing to do with you. So in the midst of that, it ain't even got nothing to do with you. Your thinking is too low for him to speak to you at the level that he really wants to. Okay. But when I became, say became. I want to examine that word became, because the word became is powerful. Genomai. Okay. Genomai. You know the word genomai in one translation means to be married to. When you genomai or become, I become married to my next level. I arise to my next level. I fulfill the requirements of my previous level that allow me to pass on. Y'all okay? Genomai also means to behave. So I behave at the level. Y'all okay? I could keep going. You become formed. You become developed. You decide. You become done. Say done. How many of y'all know that one of the best things to come home to on a Sunday is food that is done? I know when we lived at 809, yeah, I would get up early on Sunday and I put them greens on. And I had the macaroni all situated and fixed. And we was in the studio then. And I'd have the chicken or whatever we got in the crock pot, crock pocket. So that as soon as I said amen, and it is so, goodbye, Way Nation, we was making beelines in the kitchen, because the thing that had been promised and was being prepared is done. Y'all missed it now. The thing that had been promised and that was being prepared is done. Can you present your body a living sacrifice, done and acceptable for the Lord, which is your, y'all missed your shout right there. I present my body a living sacrifice, done. Y'all missed it. I present my body a living sacrifice, holy, holy, and acceptable unto God, which is my reasonable service. Am I done? See, I can't even get into the charts until tomorrow, because I got charts. I can't get into the charts until tomorrow. The charts come tomorrow, because I got to preach this other message, man. That's why I got blue up here, blue and black. That's how I preach that other message real quick. that's why I'm preaching that message. I'll leave y'all in the dark until we get there. Okay, now watch this. There's one word in the vocabulary of the believer that hell hates. It ain't delivered. It ain't free. It ain't mantled. It ain't anointed, it's done. See? I need y'all to do me one favor. Put your preaching voice on for about 30 seconds and tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, I said, put your preaching voice on and say, tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, I've came to declare one thing to you. No, that was too proper. Say, I've come to declare one thing to you. I am done. I'm done with this. I'm done with hell. I'm done with what he wants from me. I'm done with this level. I'm done with this dysfunction. I'm done at this place. I am done. I'm finished. I'm like Jesus on my cross. It is finished. It is done. Sit down. I need, you may not even be done yet, but just prophesy like you there and say, I'm done. I'm done. I'm done with that. I'm done. Come on. All right now. I gotta give y'all a prophetic act. I gotta give you a prophetic act. This how you be done. I'm done. You gotta get arrogant with, excuse me. Can I get somebody that got a little pish-posh on them real quick? Can I get somebody that got a little anointing on them real quick to do a quick prophetic act with me? Stand on your feet. Look your devil square in the face. Look the pantheon of demons square in the face and say, I am done. Come on, look back. I'm done. I'm done. I'm done. I'm done. I'm done. I'm done being immature. I'm done being offended. I'm done with unforgiveness. I'm done with crazy people. I'm done with dysfunctional living. All right, here we go. Let's go ahead. I'm done being broke. I'm done being in bondage. I'm done looking at my destiny from a place of failure. I'm done failing. I'm done being defeated. I'm done staying in the same place. I am done. I'm tired of being here. I've been here too long. I don't like the way it looks. I don't like the way it feels. I've become too big for where I am. I ain't claustrophobic. I'm just grown. I am grown and I'm gone because I'm done. I am done. I'm done. Y'all don't get me. I'm done. Come on. I'm done. You got to tell some of the folks here, I'm done. I'm done. I'm done. Mm-mm. I'm done. I'm finished. It's over. it's over. That's one of the words that hell is afraid to hear out your mouth. Because when you done, you done. Have y'all ever get that? But when you done, you done. There's some people in your life you say, I'm done with. You blocked them, ghosted them. Hold on, I'm done. Come on, come on. I'm done. I'm done with this. I'm done. I am done. Because done leads you to four D's. And I'm done. Watch this. Done leads you to four D's. You ready? It leads you to decision, diligence, discipline, and deliverance. When you become done, you make that one. It ain't a lot. It's just that one decision. I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to be this. I'm not going to succumb to this anymore. I am done. So now I gotta become diligent to make sure that my done don't get reversed. So I gotta remove everything out of my way that will contribute to my done being reversed. Okay, yeah, I talk to you a lot. I can't talk to you no more. Blocked. Done. I can't be on this social media right now. I'm finna delete the whole account. I know I got 13,000 friends. Done. Because my done is more important than how many followers I got. As much as I would love to live with you next year, I can't because I'm done. See, we were dysfunctional together. We ain't done together. See, if you was done, you'd be walking with me. Now you standing there where you at because you retired. I'm done. I'm gone. And once you get done, you get that diligence and that discipline because discipline is a regimen. That regimen, you have a regimen to connect. Wake up at this time. I go to bed at this time. I talk during this hour. I don't talk no more after this hour. This type of people cannot text me at all. You just can't get my number at all. No. Hey, how you doing? Bye. I'm not trying to be rude. I'm not trying to be nasty. I'm not trying to be unkind. But let me tell you something. My done means more than your flirting. My done means more than how you make me feel right now. My done means more than the wonderful placations of words and the serendipities of the English language that you're giving me. My done means more. I cannot go back to being undone. Because you got a day if you're going to be undone. You don't have to be like him in Isaiah 6. I saw the Lord high and lifted up. And in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. The train of his robe filled the temple. The angels stood around and said, holy, 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 and the doorposts moved. And I was a wretch undone. Once you get the discipline, then in this season, that's when God releases the deliverance. God says, I'm no longer going to waste my oil on the unworthy. I'm no longer going to waste my oil on the unworthy. Because the more I will give it to you, the less valuable it would become. Well, guess what? I want to get you out. I really, really do. But I can't get you out. Because if I get you out right now, guess what's going to happen? You'll devalue the oil. And you'll go back and be in. And it's seven times worse. So that means I got to put seven times more oil to get you out. The enemy is continuing to up the ante on your price, the price of your head. So guess what? Holy Ghost said, he's done. I'm not pouring any more oil on a fruitless venture. So if you want the oil, you gotta get done. One thing I hate is raw food. Watch this. Watch this. Raw food is not meat for consumption. God is a consuming fire. He can't consume something that's not done. So the song he was singing called The Refiner.
want to be consumed. That's what the song said. But you can't want to be consumed unless you're being tried by fire. Purified. Done. You put meat on fire, what does it become? Done. It's ready to be consumed. This is his mandate right now. This is his mandate. His mandate. His mandate. Over this room right now. Sing this, Murph. Yeah. Put those words up. Because we about to sing this tonight. All around this room, begin to stand to your feet. Come on, begin to give him worship in this place. Put it wherever it is. Just click, double click on it, and it'll find the place. Declaration.
whatever you desire. Lord, he's my life. He's tried my crown. Purified, you take whatever you desire. Lord, he's my life.
Elder Murphy, I'm going to give you a directive for the duration of this series. This is the song of the Lord for this series. Because by the time we get to the end of this in the ninth week, this is going to be so in your soul. Into the rotation. Why? This is the prayer of the righteous to the Father. Sing it to him like he's standing in front of you. Whatever you desire. right now, I want you to do something. Just take your hands that are lifted up and wrap them around yourself. And just let it begin to love on you right now. Right now. Come on. You're worthy of it. You're worthy of it. Let those arms begin to squeeze you. Let those arms begin to squeeze you. Let him just take control of those arms and let him just begin to love on you. Let his love begin to penetrate that place. Let his love begin to penetrate that place. Let it break the outer shell. Come on. He's loving on you right now. Let the tears flow. Let the tears flow. He's loving on you right now. You think the process is about pain? It's about love. He's loving on you, and he's loving you into submission. He's loving you into place. He's loving you into decision right now.
This is pure love.
Pouring my heart out to you. I'm pouring my heart out on you. I'm pouring my heart on you.
Receive your love,
pouring my heart.
I receive your love. I open my heart. To receive your love. receive your love. We receive your love. We receive your love, Lord. We receive your love. Bask in his glory. We take time to worship you, Father. We take this time, God. Stream. We're in a moment right here. I hope you thoroughly have enjoyed our service today. For someone who not know who God is, or may not have received this love before, or if you've forgotten how this love feels and you need to switch on back and come back to Him, I want you to just do me a favor. Whenever you're watching this, I just whisper this word of prayer. God, I'm sorry. I know I messed up. I know I did some wrong, but you said if I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that I'll be saved. And right now at this moment, I'm confessing that. I believe that you are Jesus. I believe that you are Christ the Lord. You died for me. You rose from the dead for me. I just want to be saved. And I want to receive that love. So God, I want to receive your love on today. So I'm choosing to be with you. I'm choosing to start over with you. I'm choosing to start my maturity right now with you. I'm choosing to start my growth and development with you. If you prayed that prayer and you believe that on tonight, then you are saved. And we welcome you into this family. We welcome you into wherever you're watching, we welcome you right now. Some of us who seasoned saints, some of us may have to pray that prayer too and say, God, I'm sorry, I messed up. I need to start all over again. This is the moment where you start. So thank you for watching. Wherever you are right now, whatever place you are, thank you for watching. Whether you're in the room, you can stay in the room and bask in his presence. Way Nation, we love you. God bless you. I'm going to pray this out. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just give you glory just for everything you've done in this room. We honor, we bless you, and we thank you for the moment to start over. And not be stagnant, oh God. Not be retarded in our development. We thank you for this moment, oh God, to realize that we were stuck. We thank you for this moment, God. And we know that there will be many more moments to come over this next series, over this next 9 weeks, oh God, so that we can grow and be more like you. So, Father, as we leave this place, but never from your presence, you're always to keep us. It's my prayer, God. Take us back to homes of peace where we may feel your love and feel your glory and feel who you are all around us, oh God. In your Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Way Nation, we'll see you tomorrow.